Hey, welcome back to Historians in Cars Getting Coffee. As you can see, we're loaded up from Starbucks here, and we're driving through West Knoxville, and I'm taking Richard to what only can be described as a secret library about the Civil War. So this is going to be very, very interesting. We'll have thoughts on that later.
It's so secret, I have to wear earplugs every time he talks about it.
That's right. And no one can know its location or what it contains. In fact, we may come out of it having seen, you know, not being able to be responsive. You know, it could be it could be a whole thing.
And I learned yesterday that potato salad recipes are very controversial around here.
Oh, that's right. There's a whole family thing. It's I don't know if it's just an East Tennessee thing or if it's a greater sort of Southern or perhaps Appalachian thing, but family recipes are really important.
And this potato salad issue gave me a new theory about the origins of the Civil War.
Which could be the case. We'll know more on that after we've been to this library. But we, you know, as we've ended the conference, you know, I just want to say we had a fantastic time at the East Tennessee Historical Society, and we just want to thank all the sponsors and community partners. There were some amazing organizations there, and the public was great. And, you know, we do really fun stuff at the East Tennessee Historical Society, at the East Tennessee History Center, and we have some amazing items. And if you've never been to the museum, you should come check it out. That's my pitch. Okay. But we're also thinking about questions, and a lot of that's kind of what's fueling a lot of this. And Richard and I have both written about Churchill and his views of Russia. And I'm working on a book on that now about Churchill and Russia. And we had a really interesting question from Professor David Frisbee, who talked about Churchill's understanding of Russia, view of Russia, particularly the Soviet Union, thinking about how important it is to project strength. That Churchill always wanted to project strength because he thought that's what the Soviets understood. And I wonder, I would argue, and I think Richard would argue, I mean, we discussed this with Professor Frisbee, that it's actually slightly more complex than that.
Yes, I mean, I think he obviously clearly did want to project strength. I mean, if you, or firmness or resolution, I mean, these things are all true. But I suppose also you've got to remember that, of course, there were very different phases in his career, and that obviously from 1941 to 1945, Britain and the Soviet Union were allies.
Right.
And that, in sort of more than that, Churchill had pursued some kind of working relationship with the Soviets since the early 1930s. I guess I would say 1934 is the key date where he really starts to make this public. There's a kind of a sort of unclear zone, if you like, between 1931 and 1934, where, you know, he doesn't really articulate publicly exactly what he thinks. But
we do know he's in conversation with Maisky.
Yeah.
Right, from the Maisky diary. So.
Even Maisky being the Soviet ambassador to Britain, of course. Yeah. From 1932 to 1943.
Yes, that's right.
But I suppose the sort of, you know, so the additional complexity, if you like, is that I think that Churchill perceived Stalin as being a rational actor.
Yes.
And the quotation which Professor Frisbee mentioned was, of course, the 1939 quotation from a broadcast that Churchill gave when he was First Order of the Admiralty. He refers to Russia as a mystery wrapped inside a riddle, inside an enigma. But then, as Professor Richard pointed out, Churchill gives the answer to that riddle and says the key to this riddle is the Russian national interest. And so, in my view, Churchill didn't, you know, think that Russia or the Soviet Union was going to be a friendly power necessarily, or that its interests were the same as those as Britain, but there could, in the face of Nazi Germany, be an overlap.
Right, their interests could align.
Exactly, their interests could align, and obviously they did align for that crucial period. So it's interesting that, you know, even just in the immediate aftermath of the 1939 Nazi-Soviet pact, Churchill was saying, well, hey, let's not suddenly use lots of hostile rhetoric towards the Soviet Union, which would kind of been understandable if he'd done it in some ways. He was actually saying, well, you know, conditions in the not too distant future may actually push Britain and the Soviet Union together.
Yeah, well, and the thing that I wanted to add is slightly more color, and this is what I told Professor Frisbee, is that, you know, in the project I'm working on, which sort of doesn't just look at Churchill and the Soviet Union, but his views of Russia in its sort of entirety and its history and in his sort of worldview, is I've gone through all the things that he's written about Russia, and and I've almost put them into a database. I'm using this to sort of as a starting point in the introduction. And one of the things that emerges is his sort of regular use of kind of descriptors about Russia being a vast, cold, yeah. unknowable. Yeah. And there's a kind of a linking in his language and rhetoric around, now I'm talking about Russia, not specifically the Soviet Union, about it being sort of Asiatic and, yes, and this yes, constant mention of Asian yes. warlords.
And that's actually a very significant point, or at least an interesting point, that he uses the word Asiatic, and he yes. doesn't like the word Asian. He's very clear he doesn't like the Asian, which he regards as an American word.
Yes, that's right. He uses the term Asiatic. And that essentially Russia is at its core sort of Asiatic power, not necessarily a European power, which I think helps establish why in his mind it's kind of unknowable. Now, yeah. and that kind of reads into his whole views of hierarchies, which I explored in my first yes. book, Church in the Islamic World. But, you know, as a component of this, I think Stalin, in many ways for Churchill, you know, because he's talking about Russia, and then, of course, the Bolsheviks come to power, and then Churchill's language about Bolsheviks become, you know, reptilian, you know, really, really condemning yeah, yeah. Bolshevism.
Yeah.
So that when Joseph Stalin comes on the scene and they meet, he does become a focal point for Churchill that's like, well, I might not understand Russia, and I definitely don't understand the Bolsheviks, but I kind of get Joseph Stalin, which is something that I think Joseph Stalin probably was able to work out and certainly used against Churchill in his negotiating tactics with him and probably Roosevelt.
I agree.